Hi there, folks, and welcome to Facebook, WMUR's Facebook page and Facebook Live with the candidate. I am joined by Senator Kelly Ayotte. Good to see you here on social media.
It is great to be with you, Josh.
You did this once already, right?
I did it in the primary with Adam.
Are you on Facebook? Do you do the whole Twitter thing?
Absolutely. Instagram, Facebook, Twitter.
What about your kids?
No, they're not doing it. They're not doing it yet.
So I know.
12 and 9, we're trying to delay doing that.
Have you identified an age yet? That's the conundrum. When do you start letting them on Facebook?
Yeah, I know. Like we're going to try to wait as long as possible.
I know. That's what I'm doing, too. Just trying to get this thing going here.
Yeah.
And the questions are going to start coming in here. 5 weeks, though. Happening fast.
Yeah, it is happening fast. Exactly.
You ready for it to be over?
You know, I'm sure people will love to have their televisions back, so yes.
Right. Okay. Bear with me here. Still. How is the campaign going, though?
It's going fine. I love being out with New Hampshire voters and campaigning and just out shaking the hands, fairs, festivals, you name it. It's all happening in New Hampshire. So
I
love that.
It never stops.
And that's what the next 5 weeks are going to be about, getting out and talking to voters.
It is. And here's our first question coming from Phil Walsh. And it's kind of a broad question, but what is the biggest difference between you and Governor Maggie Hassan?
So I would say the biggest differences between us, starting first with national security, my time in the Armed Services Committee, my husband's a combat veteran, served in Iraq, and this has been an issue I focused on keeping the country safe. And I have experience on the committee. I was the only member of the delegation to vote against automatic cuts to our military that are diminishing the readiness of our military, and so I've been fighting against those. And on the Iran agreement, this is a big difference between us. One of the first things she did when she got in this race was endorse the flawed Iran agreement, which is allowing the largest state sponsor of terrorism to keep infrastructure for nuclear weapons. They've tested ballistic missiles. The cash relief they've gotten have gone into supporting more terrorism. And so we have a big difference. I'm more prepared to handle these national security issues. She's not been able to talk about the homegrown terrorism threat post the attack in New Jersey and New York. She was asked, hey, are there other domestic terrorism cases in our country? She couldn't answer it. And unfortunately, there are. And this is something our FBI deals with every day. Over the last couple of years, there have been over 90 indictments of people engaged with ISIS or providing material support for ISIS. So I think I'm much more prepared to keep New Hampshire safe. And just another difference on that front, sanctuary cities, I think we should enforce our immigration laws, and Governor Hassan supports sanctuary cities. And when it comes to spending and taxes, I'm for you keeping more of your money in your pockets. And Governor Hassan has a history of increasing taxes on small businesses, campsites, car registrations, about 100 of them.
All right, thank you very much for the question, Phil. Next one coming from Arnie. This is an important one. A lot of people are asking this. What will you do to help develop a balanced budget and reduce the national deficit?
First of all, we need to make sure that we have regular budgeting. On the budget committee, I helped pass last year the first balanced budget in 14 years in the Senate. So every committee I serve on, I'm looking for ways to save money. So on the Armed Services Committee, we cut the missile to nowhere, which is a defense program that was never going to get a result for our troops. Actually cutting an agency, bipartisan legislation. There's this agency, these agencies in Washington, one just to get reports that you can just already get online. So our bill is called Just Google It. Eliminating duplicative programs. So we've got these audit reports, they sit on the shelf every year. So I have bipartisan legislation that will force not only the president, but the Congress to vote on all the duplication, waste, and fraud that come out in these reports. So I'm always looking for ways to get our fiscal house in order. And I think that's a really important issue in this race, because if you look at Governor Hassan's philosophy and even the spending increases she's proposed as governor, as majority leader in the Senate, I'm always gonna ask, do we need, how much does it cost? Should the federal government be doing it? What's it gonna do to our debt? And I don't think she's gonna ask those questions.
Well, debt load is getting heavier, and a lot of people are talking about it. Next question coming from David. Thanks for that question, Arnie. David wants to know, are you for privatizing Social Security?
No, I'm not. I don't support privatizing Social Security. I am for making sure that we strengthen and preserve Social Security, because right now, independent trustees have looked at it, and Social Security in 2034, we could face a 21% or more cut to the benefits of Social Security if we don't act together to preserve it. And this is one where, you know, Ronald Reagan and Tip O'Neill, good example of what we need to do. They got together, they came up with a bipartisan agreement, and they preserved Social Security for decades. We need to do that again. But I don't think privatizing it is the way to go. Preserving it is the way to go.
Entitlement reform is a big issue in this race as well. Next question coming from Jason. This is an interesting one. What do you think the right mix of clean energy to fossil fuel is for New Hampshire and nationally?
Well, I think, first of all, we need to protect New Hampshire's environment. And this is an area where I've crossed party lines going back to my time as Attorney General. I actually was involved in suing the Bush administration when I thought the regulations that were being proposed were going to make New Hampshire the tailpipe for the Midwest power plants. And in the Senate, I've done the same to preserve our land and water under the Land and Water Conservation Fund, supporting the Clean Power Plan on climate, mercury regulations, crosshair pollution regulations. And so I think we got to strike a balance. We need to continue to invest in research to develop the best technology to for our natural resources and fossil fuels so that we are developing that technology to make those cleaner, you know, whether it's on emissions and how we, you know, extract those fossil fuels, and then also continue to invest in research on clean energy. For example, solar. If we could figure out how to store solar energy more, it would be much more viable in terms of renewables. So what the exact balance has to be, the one that protects New Hampshire's environment and also allows our economy to be strong. Too often the discussion is one or the other, and I'm always looking for what's the common sense way for us to protect our environment with a combination of fossil fuels, renewable, all the above. My overall philosophy, all the above, using the best technology we can to protect our environment.
Related question, someone's asking, what's your position when it comes to the Paris Climate Agreement?
Well, I actually, you know, I think it was positive in terms of people, the countries of the world coming together to address how globally we're going to address climate change, because here's where we are. You know, we're taking steps in New Hampshire. We're taking steps nationally on the Clean Power Plan. But we also know countries like China, India, other countries in the world are continuing to contribute a substantial amount of emissions and have a big impact on the climate. So we can look at what we're doing, but if we don't engage other countries and getting them to change their behavior as well, we're not going to protect the overall environment. And so those international discussions are critical to getting other countries to step up to the plate.
What are your feelings on the USDA's added regulations under the House Protection Act? That's coming from Selena.
The USDA.
That's the question.
I want to make sure I know what it is, so let me.
All right, you know what? We'll try to come back to that. Maybe we'll figure out how to get
house protection
into
or horse protection?
House protection is what
house
it says.
House protection.
All right, we'll move on. Sorry.
I'd have to look at it, what it is, and look at the.
All right, you knew this question was coming. Bob wants to know, why won't you support your party's nominee? Obviously, talking about Donald Trump, you said you'll support him, not endorse him. Where are you with this?
Where I am is I'm going to be voting for him. But I have had some disagreements with him, and I've been quite clear on that. So I have not endorsed him. But I think if you look at where we are in this election, I think we need fundamental change. We need to go in a new direction for the country. With Secretary Clinton, I see us going in the same direction, especially on some of the policies that I've been concerned about on national security, whether it's the Iran deal, other matters. And so I will be voting for him. But I will call him like I see him. And when I disagree with them, I'm going to be clear. And when I disagree with the other side, I'm clear. And I'll be working with them when we can get good things done for the country.
Okay. Next question coming from Tom. It's been in the news a lot lately. What do you think of the recent national anthem protests by professional athletes? It's really started by Colin Kaepernick.
No, absolutely. I think, first of all, our men and women who serve this country have fought and died for the right of Colin Kaepernick to not stand up during the national anthem, but I don't have to like it, I don't have to agree with it, and I don't agree with it. I believe we have a great country. We should be standing up, putting your hand over your heart when the national anthem plays, and that's not the right way to go about addressing concerns that you have. And let me just say for a minute, you know, having served as Attorney General, I just want to make sure, you know, I'm concerned about that our police know that we stand with them. And that as I look at the racial divide that we're facing, it's going to take leadership. But it's also the police are part of the solution. And I've seen it with the communities in New Hampshire and the community policing that our police do. And I'd like to see us looking to have the police be part of the solution.
Lori says you're such a positive person. How do you deal with all the negative attacks and the ads that are out there that come from the other side?
Yeah, you know, I got a great playlist, and sometimes I just have to play it.
Who's on it?
Oh my gosh, I've got lots of great, you know, I've got Queen, I got The Script, you know, I got a little Taylor Swift, Shake It Off, we all do.
A little country?
A little country, exactly.
Put it in the iPad or the
iPod. Put it in, tune out, and I want this to be positive. See, that's the thing. You know, in terms of who's going to be New Hampshire's voice in the Senate, you should have a positive vision about what you want to accomplish, what you want to get done, and how we're going to get it done.
Obviously, a big issue here in New Hampshire is the crisis of addiction. Unique question here. Jamie wants to know, why don't we see more Vivitrol clinics and less methadone and Suboxone?
Well, I think what we need to do in general is expand our medication-assisted treatment. Obviously Vivitrol is, I think, an important medication that people should have access to, but we've also had a cap in terms of how much medication-assisted treatment that people could provide. And under the recent Comprehensive Addiction Recovery Act that I helped get passed at the national level, we're also allowing nurse practitioners to help in this too, with supervision from doctors. So part of it has been a lack of capacity, and I think Vivitrol is an important part of the for those who need medication-assisted treatment. Obviously, that to me, we should make sure that the doctors are able to do that, that we allow the capacity here, and we just don't have enough treatment capacity. And that's why we focused on the Comprehensive Addiction Recovery Act, expanding treatment and recovery, because it's not just the treatment, it's the recovery of someone leading a good quality life. And that's what Hope for New Hampshire, which is a great organization, is focusing on also.
We're getting a lot of questions focused on energy and the environment. One question is asking, would you support a climate impact study for any new infrastructure projects? And it's just scrolled up on me, so I don't have the name, but I apologize and thanks for the question.
Well, I think that when you have a major project, you're going to do an environmental impact. And that can be included in it and should be included in it. And I think
but it comes back to regulations again.
But
too.
I think we've got to do it in a way that we include it in the existing already. When you have a major project, you already have to do an environmental impact. And so if we include it in that assessment, it makes sense. And I think we need to make it easy for businesses to do it too, right? To not do it in a way that we get the information, we make the decisions, and we also make sure it's done in an efficient way. So it's not dragging projects out for years. We find out what the impact is, we assess it, we figure out if there needs to be mitigation, and we get things done while also protecting the environment.
This is working for you, at least as far as Elizabeth's concerned. She says, good answer, you have our vote. Not sure what answer she's talking about, but there you go. Next question, centering on immigration.
Yes.
This keeps scrolling on me, so I'm going to have to kind of paraphrase it a little bit. Basically, would you still support the Gang of Eight bill when it comes to immigration, something you had supported in the past?
Yeah, I mean, I voted for it. It wasn't a perfect bill, but there were some good pieces of that bill. Let me just lay it out. That bill, in terms of the illegal immigration problem, doubled the amount of border fencing, it doubled the amount of border agents, it created an entry-exit system. Right now, 40% of the people who are here illegally actually overstay a visa, and so it's absurd that we don't have an entry-exit system. It created that. It would have strengthened the E-Verify system to make sure it was throughout the country and workable for the private sector too. And then on the legal front, it would have dealt with the issue of reforming our legal system to make it about people coming here that want to be a productive part of our society, help us make the country stronger, and we are a country of immigrants. It would allow that. And what it did do is we have 11 million people who are here illegally. Send back the criminals. That's what it said, and I think that's important. We send back the criminals. And the people who are here illegally, they can't get in front of anyone else. They got to get in the back of the line before they have legal status. They got to pay taxes, learn English, have a job. And so we have to have a logical way to deal with the immigration issue, starting first with the security issue. And that's why, you know, I think any solution we're going to have is going to have any, you know, entry exit system, going to enhance that border, is going to make sure we're dealing with the illegal system. And let me mention one other thing again, to go back to sanctuary cities.
Yeah.
Again, we've had separate votes on the Senate floor on the sanctuary city issue. No matter what we do, we've got to enforce our laws. We've got to deal with it, address it, and then enforce those laws. Because, you know, a sanctuary city is a situation where they're not the locals are basically told don't cooperate with the federal officials on immigration violations. And we can't have that happening anywhere on any kind of laws. People have to be able to work together.
You know, go ahead, please.
Just to mention, I mean, again, this is a big difference between Governor Haas and I. She supports sanctuary cities. I would not.
Social media, I mean, we're on this now. Tons of people are on it. Do you think that when it comes to national security and detecting the possibility of homegrown terror, that we're up to speed as far as what can be done without violating privacy? You know, monitoring what's going on out there and the chatter and the things that could be plotted.
What we've seen is, first of all, Twitter, Facebook, other social media sites have taken down, you know, thousands and thousands of, you know, ISIS-related sites. So the private sector, encouraging them to do more of that is critical. And they're trying to. They don't want ISIS to use their sites either. But we know that ISIS is actually using social media to encourage people in our country to self-radicalize and to commit attacks here. So we've got to deal with that, asking the private to take it down where they find terrorism-related sites. But also, we've got to give our first responders the tools that they need. Right now, the FBI is being limited in terms of their ability to get what's called electronic transaction records. So they can get business records, they can get phone records. They used to be able to issue a national security letter to get not your content, but to get like where you signed up, you know, your profile, and then if they need more information, to get a warrant to get in the content. And we had a vote on the Senate floor on that. It failed by one vote. And we need to fix it, because when I was a prosecutor, I could get that information with a subpoena from the AG's office in an internet predator case, a murder case, a child porn case. And the notion that we aren't giving that basic tool to the FBI just strikes me as absurd.
Next question, and it missed the name, but it centers on the Supreme Court. You've been asked about this a lot. You've stood with Mitch McConnell not to have a hearing on Merrick Garland, the president's nominee. A lot of people are asking why. The Senate had the majority, Republicans had the majority in the Senate, could have had the hearing and voted him down if that was the decision.
Because I think we're in a situation that's a situation that's very important, and it's somewhat unique. You've got a 4-4 court. We lost a tremendous justice with Justice Scalia, and you've got divided government. And we know that that next justice is going to shift the court in one way or the other, unfortunately. And so this is really important. When you think about what's at stake in this presidential election, the people weigh in terms of who they elect to nominate the next justice of the Supreme Court, and that we have the confirmation process there. Why? Divided court, divided government, your constitutional rights at stake for decades. So that's why I thought that in this situation, it was really important that the people of this country weigh in.
Next question is coming from, bear with me here, John, and it centers on veterans. And you're asked about this all the time, and this is something that you talk a lot about, but people feel like veterans aren't getting the care that they need. John wants to know why.
And John is right. You know, I'm the wife of a combat veteran, and I got to tell you, our veterans are not getting the care that they earn defending our nation. And in part, it's because the bureaucracy. The VA makes it so hard on our veterans. Before I actually came to this Facebook meeting like this, my staff was on the call with the VA system on this VA choice program. And Senator Shaheen and I have worked, because we don't have a full service hospital, to allow our veterans to go seek care in their communities. All 26 hospitals have signed up and wanting to participate in that program.
Yeah, what's holding it up?
And what's holding it up is bureaucracy and middleman. The VA set this system up so the veteran has to call this middleman, and they're trying to set up the appointment. They're going to determine whether they're eligible. We need to eliminate that middleman, give the veteran a card, say, here's your network, all 26 hospitals, you can go anywhere you want. and treat it like TRICARE or other cards, and let our veterans go with their own feet, schedule their appointment, not wait in line, and get the best care that they deserve defending this nation. I've introduced legislation to make that happen. I'm working with Senator Shaheen to make that happen, and this is a top priority of mine because our veterans deserve the very best, and nothing makes me angrier when I learn about what our veterans are going through. And we're helping a lot in our office to try to help different veterans, but they shouldn't have to come to their member of Congress. They should just have it right, make it easy for our veterans.
Al's asking the question, a bit more of a statement, but eminent domain, what's your position? I mean, this is what's talked a lot about as far as Northern Pass and you know, the gas line.
I think we have to be quite careful when we use eminent domain, and it can only be for the public benefit, and we have to protect people's rights. And you know, this is obviously I'll tell you one thing, I didn't like the Supreme Court decision in New London versus Connecticut years ago, which I thought went too in favor of the ability to take people's property for insufficient reasons. So I weigh in on the side of making sure that you have to protect people's rights, their property. And that was a big Supreme Court decision. If I could come up with one Supreme Court decision that I would disagree with, that one was on the top of my list.
All right. Cassie wants to know, what's your favorite place in New Hampshire?
My favorite place, I would have to say Mount Washington, but my couch is pretty good. And also locally, I live in Nashua, so mine's Falls Park is where I like to run. And that just is awesome because I actually started my day today. I went out for a little run.
Deborah wants to know, what's being done to help homeless in New Hampshire? Obviously, you know, this is probably not talked about as much as it has been in the past, but it does exist and it's still a problem.
Yeah, I think obviously there's been a big effort from HUD that I've been supportive of programs that help end homelessness, get people into shelter. We also need more affordable housing. So we're in a state where the affordable housing issue is a big deal. So many families just, they can't find housing that they can afford. So I've been supporting expanding the low-income housing tax credit to create more affordable housing. And at the HUD level on homelessness, let me just point out something that I had to deal with that I've been disappointed with. HUD, I think, is trying to put in programs to get the homeless into shelter, and that's all been good. But they changed their regulations, and places like Liberty House, which does a great job serving our veterans who are homeless and getting them in a wonderful house where people care about them. They made it so they're a sober facility. They made it so if you're just a sober facility, then you weren't gonna be able to get federal funds. So I actually got an amendment passed in the Senate on an appropriations bill this year to say that places like Liberty House could still be eligible for HUD funds, because we know there's some great places in our community. Some are sober houses like Liberty House, and why wouldn't we want to have all the options to serve our homeless population and our veterans? Unfortunately, nothing is more upsetting than to know that some of our veterans are homeless.
We only have a couple of minutes to go, trying to get to many of these questions as we can. Next question is coming from Andrew, talking about the Family Leave Act, paid leave programs. Mm-hmm. Wants to know if the burden should fall on the businesses to make sure that you know, there's something available when it comes to paid family leave.
Mm-hmm. So I think, first of all, I have legislation that would allow more opportunity for flex time. I think that's critical, and that's why I've introduced that. And I also think that we can give, one of the things I've been supportive of is giving some more tax opportunities for flexible spending accounts, expanding those, and also businesses further incentives to provide paid leave for their employees.
Next question, Tom. When will the government help seniors so they don't have to depend on their kids? Broad question, but obviously.
No, it's a broad, it's sure. A really important question. And I think it starts with making sure we strengthen and preserve Social Security and Medicare, because those are the very important senior programs that often, if we don't strengthen and preserve them, then that's obviously my grandparents, like my meme and my grandfather, they both lived in their 90s and they couldn't have made it without Medicare and Social Security. So I think that is really critical. I also think one of the things I know is for caregivers, I'm co-sponsoring legislation for a tax credit for caregivers that that is important, you know, so that we can have an ability of family members to help our seniors and those who need the help. And I also think we have to deal with, you know, all this stuff gets passed on to seniors in terms of costs. So the more affordable we make it for our families, whether it's on healthcare issues, whether it's on, you know, how much food costs and energy costs, that's all going to help our seniors.
Let's end with a question coming from Elizabeth. On the minds of a lot of people. And it's a broad question again. Why is this election so negative? And she goes on to say, what can we do to make the negative ad stop? That speaks to Citizens United to a certain degree, but
yeah,
just the tone of this thing, you haven't seen it like this before.
Yeah, no, there's been so many false negative ads on the TV, and some of you out there on Facebook may have seen my baseball ad, but that was one of my points in that ad, because there is a lot coming at a candidate like me that just isn't true. And when I first, when I got in the Senate race and when Governor Hassan got in the race to run against me, I offered her what's called the People's Pledge. And that was in place in the Mass Senate race between Elizabeth Warren and Scott Brown. And actually Senator Cheney offered it in her race with Scott Brown. And what it did in the Mass race is the parties agreed essentially, we're gonna create a penalty system if this outside money comes in to support either of us. And it kept most of the outside money out. And unfortunately, Governor Hassan did not take the People's Pledge. And I wanted all this outside money out. I wanted it to be about our campaigns and really about what we stand for and what the differences are in this. So I'm disappointed she didn't take it. But I think part of it was, is obviously, you know, the people who are spending all the money, whether it's Harry Reid and others, that about our Senate race, is that money, she wanted that money to come in. I think we should have agreed as parties to try to keep that money out, and it's disappointing that she wouldn't accept that.
But when this election is over, no matter who wins at the top of the ticket, someone's going to have to extend the olive branch, because this nation faces huge problems, debt, deficit, national
yes.
security, entitlements, whatever. I mean, we've had a list of them right here.
Well, and I
How does that begin?
That begins, I'm one of the most bipartisan senators, and that's how it begins. It begins by looking for ways that you can extend an open hand and look for common ground. And I know when we do that, that we can fix our problems, we can get things done. Because all the major issues and challenges we face in this country, it's taken both parties working together to get them done. And that's really my goal. I wake up, I look for common ground to fight for New Hampshire and for this country. And that's why I do have one of the most bipartisan records. It's why I want to run again. It's really my passion, because we need more of that, not less of that, in our nation's capital on our behalf with the great challenges that we face.
Well, we are out of time, and I appreciate everybody out there in cyber world who asked
their
questions.
Thanks.
And thanks for joining us, and thanks. Best of luck to you moving forward.
Awesome. Thanks, Josh.
See you
great
next
to
time.
Be with you.
Good to see you.
See ya.